who has been saying that these people are terrorists? That is the factor which is under investigation. That needs to be centrally placed here. And that, once that aspect has been interrogated and examined and investigated, will we be able to move any... No, let me finish one more thing. In so far as... Yes, please.
No, one second. I just want to come in because I haven't gone to Mr. Vyas. Ms. Brinda Grover, I'll come to you. You say today that you take the NIA document completely at face value. I just want to point out three things. Three things for your submission. G.K. Pillai retired, if I'm not mistaken, in the summer of 2011. In November 2011, G.K. Pillai says she was part of a terrorist module. Okay? In December 2011, NIA submits a report of 115 majors which totally contradicts G.K. Pillai and does not make a mention of this document. Now this document comes up. This document is of 2010, by which logical assumption, the only logical assumption one can make is that there was an investigation going on. G.K. Pillai knew about it. G.K. Pillai spoke on the information which was there with him at hand. The government changed the facts in the NIA report presented in December 2011, exactly in the 11-month run-up to the Gujarat elections. And hence the possible fact that for political reasons facts were kept at bay cannot be ruled out, and there is a political context in which all of this is happening. That's the only submission I'm making tonight. Are you open to that point of view? Are you open to that?
No,
you're not.
Yeah, can I just respond to that very, very quickly? No, I haven't answered, so please don't answer on my behalf. Can the political context, why are there two persons of the BJP here to say that X is a terrorist and this document is, the so-called NIA report is correct? Why are they there? That is the political context. Who wants to stop this investigation from moving further? And who wants the portrayal of Ishrat Jahan as a terrorist? Who stands to gain from that?
The answer is one of these gentlemen.
I don't think there is anything.
By the way, I reiterate most humbly that there was meant to be a Congress spokesperson who could not make it on the show 10 minutes before the debate started. Mahesh Jethmalani, it won't be fair if I come to you without going to Jayanarayan Vyas, because the second BJP person has not spoken yet. You've heard the argument she's placed tonight. As far as this new document is concerned, I don't think it merits a question. Your response to Brinda Grover, please. Mr. Vyas.
Thanks, Arnav. First of all, at least you realize that I am on the debate.
I'm sorry.
I thought I was balanced against the Congress spokesperson. So I'm glad. Thank you very much. Now, number one, the first thing I'd like to make as an observation is, I was carefully listening to what Brinda was saying. I admire her as the counsel of Shamima Kausar.
Yes.
And she argued her case very well. So she is well prepared for the courtroom presentation. If BJP is making anything that is politically tainted and biased, then what would you say for a lawyer who is arguing so strongly in favor of the client whom she represents at the court of law? So, in the first instance, I will say that her views will obviously are going to be tainted, and therefore, they should be discounted for whatever they are worth. I would endorse fully what Mahesh was saying. This story itself, as you know, Arnab, is full of twists and turns. MHA first has an affidavit, makes a U-turn, and goes back on that. Then you have this NIA thing coming up. Today, again, the Home Minister of the country says that he doesn't say that there is nothing that says that she was a terrorist or she had a terror link or something like that. In a guarded manner, he would have said it if it was so. But he did do that. Very tactfully, he says that because this is covered under the bilateral agreement between FBI and the CBI in this country, it is not in the public domain.
No, come to the point. No, Mr. Vyas, Mr. Vyas, let me ask you a question. Let me pointedly pin you down on one question. My first question to you is, you believe this document? You and Mahesh Jethmalani believe this document? You believe the NIA document I put out? You think it's true? Okay. So Mr. Jethmalani says, yes, fine. And I presume Jayanarayan Vyas, you say it's true as well. Now, if this document is true...
Go ahead, Adam. I'm listening to it.
Thank you. You see, this document says that in late 2005, Zakir Rahman Lakhvi introduced Muzammil to me. Right? It says in the meeting between Headley and Muzammil happened in late 2005. Mukul Roy, who's the other lawyer associated with this case, he rebutted this part by saying...
Mukul Sinha,
in his rebuttal to this, said that another part of the same document says that Headley met Muzammil in 2002. Right? So I'm only playing devil's advocate. Tell me, Mr. Jethmalani and Mr. Jairam Vyas, how can one part of this document, if it is true, say that Headley met Muzammil in 2005 and another part say he met him in 2002? It's just not possible. Is it? It's not possible.
It's completely possible.
How?
It's completely possible because the first time he met Muzammil was as a trainee in 2002, and second time he met him when he had gone up the ranks in 2005. It's completely consistent.
Mr. Jethmalani, you're getting on thin ice out here.
That's not what he says.
I think I'm going to allow Brinda a rebut on this one. Yeah, I'm going to come back. Yes, Ms. Grover, go ahead. Let's go with the rebut. I'm allowing a rebut to Brinda Grover.
Let her allow a rebut.
Can I allow a rebut?
Let me also know if Mukul Sinha is correct that he cannot meet him in 2002 and 2005.
No. What
are the evidences relying upon which he is making this statement? If you don't believe Mahesh, then tell me relying upon what you are trying to believe Mukul Sinha.
Relying upon what I am believing Mukul Sinha, you are asking me? I'm putting a question out.
I am asking you, Arnab.
Thank you.
Because you are questioning the theory that is built up by Mahesh, the construction that he has made.
Please understand.
That 2002 he might have met him when
Mr. Jainarayan Vyas. Mr. Vyas, one second. I am professionally trained to ask questions. That's what I'm good at. So I'm asking you here that while this NIA document speaks of Headley being aware of the Ishrat module, there have been questions raised over the discrepancies in the NIA document with respect to the date that Headley met Muzammil. And by the way, the new NIA document, of which I have a copy, says that in late 2005, Zakir Rahman Lakhvi introduced Muzammil to be. The operational word being introduced. Introduced. How can you introduce somebody for the first time in 2005 and introduce somebody?
That is what I wanted to point out, that the document that both the BJP spokesperson
are claiming on
as gospel truth.
Let her respond.
May I please speak, Arnab?
Yeah, go ahead. And then the others will respond to you. Go ahead.
Yeah, the document that they are claiming is gospel truth, which incidentally, just for all of us to remind ourselves, is the interrogation of a double agent trained by agencies of two states, Pakistan and the US. So I really don't know what kind of reliance we want to place on all this stuff. But for whatever it's worth, the document that they are relying upon, and that's exactly the portion I wanted to read out which you mentioned, on being asked about Ishrat Jahan, I state that in late 2005, Zakir Rahman Lakhvi introduced Muzammil to me. Having introduced Muzammil, Zaki talked about the accomplishments, etc., etc., etc. The next para says, Headley stated that apart from this, he had no other information/knowledge about Ishrat Jahan. So also to point to another question, I must fill in the blanks on the etc., etc. You can read all that, and of course you can read it. Don't worry, your other panelists have read it many, many times. Let me just finish. On the so-called evidentiary value of this. So X says that Y told me that Z told him that he knows her.
Who decides?
I mean, this is brilliant. The other two people are also lawyers. Let me not show any disrespect to their legal acumen. Unlike Mr. Vyas, who always commences his intervention by a personal attack, which I think is highly inappropriate.
Now, by the way, I just say, etc., etc., etc. Was the part...
No, absolutely not. I think this identity, the people must know that you are a party interested in arguments you are making. What is wrong in it? Your views cannot be taken
Mr.
as impartial. Nobody in the world will, in the right sense of mind,
we are all having a very, 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 very...
Since you are representing your client, how can you expect us to certify whatever you are saying? Party. He is absolutely impartial.
I don't want any certificate from you. I am telling you, argue on facts. Stop boring
your views
the public. Stop boring people.
I have simply said... That you are the
okay. You made your point.
Now, I heard you.
You made your point. She's no. One sec. Let's pull back. You've made your point. She's objected. You've reiterated your point. She said she heard you. Now I want to move on. One second, gentlemen. We are on a very critical point right now, where Brinda Grober says that the new document is perhaps inconsistent. In fact. That this document cannot be believed, Mahesh Jethmalani, because
apart
one
from
part...
We don't know its authenticity.
Well, you don't know it's not authentic either, but Mahesh Jethmalani is responding to you.
Now, I know. The simplest way...
Yeah, I don't know whether anybody else is a terrorist either.
All right.
Go on.
All right, Vrinda, when you've quite finished, let us know.
Go on.
All right. Arnav. Whether this document emanates, as I said, it is paragraph 168 of the NIA's report. Out of its 117 pages, 168 and 169 were omitted. It was sanitized deliberately. Now, let the NIA, will the NIA please tell us, not what the Express has very insidiously said, but let the NIA itself tell us whether this formed part of its interrogation report of David Headley or not. First, let us do that, and then please tell us who is responsible for its sanitization and why. Those are questions which I am legitimately entitled to ask, not as a BJP member, but as a citizen of this country, entitled to know the state of affairs and the competence of
as
the National Investigating Agency.
Point number two.
When everybody accuses Mr. Pillay of doing a U-turn, now please see what the Indian Express reports about Mr. Pillay's statement. He says, to the reason why he's done this U-turn, this time, if it can be called a U-turn, is, to the best of my knowledge, there is no mention of Ishrat in Headley's 117-page interrogation report submitted by NIA before me. In other words, it was sanitized by whoever was passful enough to sanitize it, even from the eyes of Mr. Pillay.
You're saying the Home Secretary was kept in the dark. This is exactly the point.
The Home Secretary was possibly duped.
The facts were kept away from him. So 5 months after his retirement, he was saying one thing, and 3 weeks after that, something else happened in the NIA document. I'm sorry, but Miss Brinda Grover, as a citizen of this country, why would you not ask this question to yourself? Why wouldn't you?
I'm asking many, many questions. Unfortunately, some citizens do not wish to ask all the questions. I actually want to ask all the questions. I want to ask...
Ask them.
And since Mr. Jethmalani categorically said that he wants to know this as a citizen and not a BJP person, I think that's very important. As a citizen, he should want to know why... Four people in prior custody, regardless of who they were killed in cold blood, and then it was portrayed as a fake encounter by the crime branch of a state, and now the scanner is the IB itself, as well, can I finish please, as well as the political leadership whose names have come in a 164 statement by a police officer of Gujarat. I have never said so. So as a citizen, why is that question not relevant? Why is it not scandalizing? Why is it not worrying? This is the governance and the institutions that should be extremely
what
worrying.
What about the editing of the NIA document? What about the possible editing of the NIA document?
Well, please ask the NIA, please ask the MHA, please ask the Intelligence Bureau, which also has the ear of the poor Home Secretary who today, suddenly we all are enlightened, has been duped. The Home Secretary is also provided information, as just last week everybody in BJP enlightened us that the IB reports to certain people in the central government. The Home Secretary must also have received information from the IB.